Yeah, that you'll be faithful to your word and draw us unto yourself. Father, I thank you for each person that's here today. Lord, I know that it's not by chance, but God, by divine intervention, that you have us here, Lord, because you want to meet with us in a special way. And Father, I pray today that whatever we're going through, whatever our trial, whatever our struggle, whatever our difficulty is, Lord, today that we would come, that you'd speak to us and challenge us, Lord, that we would be able to get rid of that, get free of it, Lord, to be able to surrender to you and submit to you. Father, I pray that you'd meet needs here today. Lord, I know that we all have something that we're going through, and I pray, Lord, that we're able to surrender to you. Father, I just ask today that we would see you move in a powerful way, and God, as you move in this place, Lord, that we would give you the glory for it all. We pray for those who are on our prayer list, Lord, those who are sick, those who are hurting, those who are without, those who are going through difficulties, whatever they may be, whether it be relational, whether it be physical, God, whether it be mental or spiritual, we just pray, Lord, that your Holy Spirit would work in their lives. God, that you would use us as a church to reach out, to love them, to care for them. For those who are hurting, Lord, we just ask God for you to give them peace and comfort and strength as only you can. Lord, we pray today asking you to be here, asking you to show up. Lord, we invite you into this place. Pray, God, that in the name of Jesus that you show up and that you work in our lives in a powerful way. Father, we pray in the power of the blood of Jesus Christ that Satan be removed from this place, that we'd be able to focus upon your Holy Spirit, that your Holy Spirit would be able to work and move in us, Lord, to bring us to where we need to be with you. God, we give you the glory for all things. We thank you most of all for salvation that comes through Jesus Christ and him alone. Lord, I pray that we would live in such a way that others see Jesus in through us, that they come to know you. Lord, help us to stand in you. Help us to live for you. God, help us to be a blessing to you and to others around us. For it's in the name of Jesus we pray today. Amen. If you will stand with us and begin our worship, we have our offering plates up front if you want to come and give your offering. Also, as we're going through our worship today, if you want to greet one another, feel free to do so. We'd love for you to do that as well. As we sing, stand in your love. The darkness tries to roll over in my bones. Sorrow comes to steal the joy I had. When brokenness and pain is all I know. said.
Amen.
Amen.
Tasted all that this world has to offer.
With every breath that I am in.
Good morning. Good to see each and every one of you here this morning. If you have your Bibles, you can take them and turn with me to Matthew chapter 11. We sing a song, and the lyrics are simple, yet profound. They say something like this: are you hurt and broken within? Overwhelmed by the weight of your sin? Jesus is calling. Have you come to an end of yourself? Do you thirst for a drink from the well? Jesus is calling. Leave behind your regrets and mistakes. Come today. There's no reason to wait. Jesus is calling. Bring your sorrows and trade them for joy. From the ashes, a new life is born. Jesus is calling. I'm sure that some of us here today are carrying a load. We're all honest, we're all carrying a load, right? We all have some things that feels like from time to time we've got the weight of the world on our shoulders. Not trying to be a salesman, but if I were to tell you this morning that you don't have to carry that load all by yourself, what would you do? The advertisement says, look, here it is. Here's a way to get free of this burden that you're carrying. Many times we think, you know what? It's too good to be true. The number one thing that's advertised right now in America today is how to lose weight. Don't matter where you go. It's in newspapers. It's on magazines. It's anytime you click on the internet, it's there. Over 75% of TV commercials have something to do with how you can lose weight. In some way, shape, or form. We're not satisfied with ourselves. We want to get rid of our weight. And some of us have tried a lot of different things to do so. It's been Jenny Curry. It's been keto. It's been grapefruit. You name it, you name it, you name it. Whatever the diet may be, we've gone on it. We fasted. We've done it all. Seems like we'd lose two and we gain five. Anybody been there? Okay. Y'all need to quit losing it because I'm starting to find it. I'm getting tired. I don't like it. I don't like that. But with our burdens, it seems like the more we get, the more we want. The more we want to carry rather than to be set free. And then I want to ask you a question. Simple question. Is Jesus a sounding board? Or is he a burden bearer? Do we come to Jesus just to complain and grumble and confess? And throw out, I need this, and I need that, and this person needs this, the Lord did, you know. Or is he someone that we go to realizing that he can help us out what we're going through in life? It's just like any commercial that's out there. You see the commercial, you hear the advertisement, you have to decide for yourself, is this worth buying? Is it worth me investing in for what it says the return is going to be? And I hope today that you find out, that you'll come to realize that Jesus is worth investing. That the return is very well worth it. If you have your Bibles in Matthew chapter 11, if you'll stand with me, we're going to look at three verses. Starting in verse number 28, Jesus is talking. And he says, come to me, all you who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and lowly in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light. Father, we thank you for the truth of your word. And I pray this morning, God, as we look at you being a burden bearer and not just a sounding board. And Father, as we find the truth that's there, that we would accept the invitation. We would accept the invitation come to you, Lord, and allow you to do your part in this thing called life. Father, I pray that you hide me behind the cross. It's not me that speaks, but your Holy Spirit that speaks through me. I ask, Lord, now for the words of my mouth, the meditations of my heart, be acceptable to you, O God. For it's in the name of Jesus I pray. Amen. You may be seated. As we look at this passage of Scripture, three short verses, which I'm sure you're very familiar with, the first thing I want you to see is the authority of Jesus saying, come unto me. He's making an invitation. He's sending an invitation out. And here in Scripture says, come to me, all you who are burdened or laboring and heavy laden. Anybody in here labor? Anybody in here carrying a burden? Anybody in here have a little bit more than you think you deserve or more than you can carry and bear on your own? You're like looking up to God and saying, okay, God, when is enough enough? Do you not get it, Lord? This is weighing me down. It's holding me back. This is difficult for me to go through right now. It's an invitation. It's not a command. Many times in Scripture, we see Jesus saying go. We see Jesus saying do this and do that. He told Moses, I want you to go and set my people free. He told the disciples right before his ascension, which is a command to us as the church, to go into all the nations and preach the gospel, baptizing them in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. But here he's not saying go. He is saying come. An open invitation for us to come to Jesus. A personal invite for whoever reads it and whoever hears it. Now the decision has to be made. Will I accept that invitation? You ever got an invitation in the mail? Right now, car dealerships want you to come and buy cars, and you get those invitations. There's a key there, right? Take that key. You might be the lucky winner, and you look at it, I don't think so. At least that's what I say. Maybe you take it and go and check it out. I ain't wasting my time. They just want you to stay and spend all your Saturday, whatever day you decide to show up, trying to get your money, and then, you know, whatever. But they want you to come, or you got a friend or family, they invite you to a party, birthday party, something like that, and you read the invitation, and everything's laid out, and you're like, yeah, I'm going to go to that, and then all of a sudden, something happens, something comes, and you don't go. Jesus is making an invitation. He is asking for us to come. He is quietly making a personal invite to everyone, all people, who are going through struggles in this life. Have you been criticized? I have been criticized many, many times by friends and fellow ministers of the gospel and other denominations. Why do you give an invitation at the end of your messages? I said, because Jesus did. Oh, no, that's not biblical. Anybody read the word? Did Jesus not say, come unto me? All. God's called me to preach the truth. Allow the Holy Spirit to do His part, and then it's our choice as to whether we will follow the conviction the Holy Spirit leads upon our life to trust Jesus and come. But an invitation is perfect and needed. And here, it's something that we need to accept as an invitation from Jesus saying, come. And I will give you rest. How many of you tired today? Anybody tired? Some of us are tired because we stayed up all night. We didn't sleep well. We didn't rest well. Some of us are tired because our mind will not shut down for everything that's going on. Some of us are tired for so many other reasons. Some of us are tired wondering and thinking, man, what's heaven going to be like? Am I going to get there? And Jesus said, if you'll come, I'll give rest for your soul. For your soul. But not only do we see an invitation, the authority of Jesus giving the invitation, I want you to see who Jesus was calling unto himself right here. Who is he calling? Jesus says, come to me, all who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Jesus said, first, I'm calling all who are burdened. That word labor means to be burdened. How many of y'all work a job? You have a burden that you carry. Years ago, back in the first century, the burden was the backpack or what you carried to work to do your job, whatever the tools of the trade were. And a Roman soldier could come up to you and say, you know what, I want you to carry my burden for a mile. It was actually law that you, as a citizen of wherever, had to take that and carry it a mile. And if you remember Jesus later on in Scripture, he said to him in Matthew chapter 5, verse 41, whoever compels you to go 1 mile, don't just go one, go another. Go the extra mile. Don't just do what's required of you, but go above and beyond that. So Jesus said, he's calling all who have a burden, who are heavy laden. The burden, the labor, what we deal with, the things that we go through in this life. Jesus wasn't calling a self-righteous person or self-dependent person or the self-made man that we hear about all the time today or the self-sufficient individual. No, Jesus was calling somebody who was willing to learn, to grow, to be discipled, to be encouraged. Somebody who was going through a difficult situation and struggle in life, calling them to come and allow him to work with them. You struggle in life? You have struggles? Do you have concerns for yourself? For your family, for other people around you. Do you have stuff that just happens? We call that life, sickness, pain, hardships. Anybody fatigued with debt, jobs, broken relationships, failures, unaccepted by others, loneliness, hopelessness, heartache, and disappointments? You see, if you're in this life, alive and vibrant, we all have things that we deal with. We all have stuff, and that stuff is our labor. It's what we go through. And Jesus is saying, come and let me help you with life. So many times we're like, Jesus, yeah, I don't need you in this area of my life. Jesus, this little area over here is kind of my playtime. It's my fun time. It's where I get to please me time. Jesus, I really prefer you to stay out of my life in this area, and then we wonder why the rest of the areas are so burdensome and so tiring and so fatiguing and hold us down and drag us down. But Jesus said, look, if you labor, if you'll come to me, I will help bear the load. But he don't say, he don't just stop there for those who labor, because we're all called to labor. We all have to go through this life. But then he goes on and says, heavy laden. And what is heavy laden? Well, heavy laden are the burdens that are put on you by other people. Any moms in here have any burdens put on you by children in the home? I need my clothes washed. I need to make sure that dinner's cooked at some time. Mom, will you come and help me make up my bed? Will you come and put my clothes in the drawer for me? Will you see if this is okay? Some of y'all look at me and be like, huh? Maybe you can't remember back when you had children that you had to do that. Sometimes at 22 years old, we have to do that for my daughter too. My wife will wash her clothes and fold them and put them on the bed, and God only knows what's clean and what's dirty. Because if you go in her room, it's like a tornado or a bomb or something. Just boom. All that hard work going to naught. Do we have burdens put on us by other people? Dad, see, Jesus spoke of this to the Pharisees in Matthew chapter 23, verse 4. He said, for they bind heavy burdens, hard to bear, and lay them on men's shoulders, but they themselves will not move one of them with their fingers. Restrictions and guidances and legalism and things that we feel like we've got to do to be able to survive in this world. We're studying To Kill a Mockingbird at school with my 9th grade English class. And if you've never read it, it's a good book. It talks about the race wars that we've had been going on for a long time, written by a female writer, Harper Lee, back a long time ago. And the problem was a black man and a white woman kissed. Wow. Some of you right now, your blood's curdling. That's all I just said, dude. The burdens of the unknown things of society. The things that pressure us down, the demands that others will throw upon us, yet they're not willing to help us out. Extra work from your boss. Expectation from a spouse or a family member, a child, a parent, or a sibling. The unsaid do's and don'ts that say this is right and this is wrong. Religious exercise. Chores to help make our family function. Or caring for someone in need. The extra things. I hear so many people say after they retire, I don't know how I was able to work. Because there's so much stuff we can get involved in. There's so many other things that are out there that we could weigh ourselves down with and burden ourselves down with, and we think we've got to be busy and we think we're doing a good thing, yet all the while we're dragging ourselves and binding ourselves and making our souls weary. And Jesus is saying, come, come unto me, and I will give you rest. I want you to see what Jesus offers. What Jesus offers to those who come. We see there in Scripture, he says in verse number 29, take my yoke upon you and learn from me. For I'm gentle, lowly in heart, and you will find rest for your souls, for my yoke is easy and my burden is light. Jesus is offering for you to come and allow him to switch out your yoke, so to speak. You see, the yoke was a tool in the first century in which they would bind two animals together to be able to do a task. Maybe it was carry a cart, maybe it was plow a field. Who knows, it may be to destroy a building. But they would tie two animals together, and most often they would tie a more mature animal to a less mature animal that may be stronger, so that there would be guidance taking place. So that the more mature animal, who knew how to listen, who knew how to follow, would go and pull and compel and follow the instruction of the master. And so Jesus is saying, hey, here's what I want you to do. I want you to shoulder up under my yoke. Jesus isn't saying, come to me and I'll take all your cares and do away with it. He's not saying, come to you and life will just be perfect and you know, you'll be able to live with rose-colored and stained glasses the rest of your life and all things will be good. No, he's saying, come, there's still work to do, but I will shoulder up and help you through the task. The yoke is not a gift. It's implying that all the work's going to be gone. Yet Jesus was saying there will be work and there is work. But I'm willing to guide you if you're willing to be instructed. I'm willing to teach you if you're willing to learn. I'm willing to disciple you if you're willing to follow. Every day I have students raise their hand, Mr. Enzi, I don't understand how to do this. I can't do this. I don't want to do this. Some of you kids have been that way in school, right? Some of you have kids like that at home. Mom, I can't do this. Dad, I need your help. Some of those parents are 50 and 60 years old and needing that help, right? And you're going to them, I can't do this. This thing called life is tough. Will you help me out? And so many times, rather than teaching them, we'll just go and take care of it ourselves, don't we? Because we know that if we get through this teaching moment, it might become a battle and a struggle. And my students raise their hand, Mr. Ramsey, I don't understand that. No. And so I go over there and they're like, all right, he's going to do it for me. I'm like, okay, let's look at it together. What's the question asking? And they'll tell me. Now, what do you think would be a good answer? Okay, write that down. Yeah, you, not me, you write it down. Okay, now let's look at it again. Do we answer? No, there's more. Okay, what else do you think? And then we go through it until I didn't do anything but bring out of them what was already there. And then they become successful and they realize they can. They realize that they do have the knowledge. They do have the understanding. And then once they see that there's success, you know what? They're willing to do the next problem by themselves. And Jesus is saying, if you'll come and you'll take my yoke, guess what? Life is still going to be life. Life is still going to be difficult. There's still stuff that's going on, but guess what? I'm going to lead you. I'm going to guide you. I'm going to work with you. I'm going to help you along the way. I'm going to show you which direction to go. We're going to pull the sled together, so to speak. Many times in the first century, especially in the Jewish culture and in the religion of Judaism, the yoke was expressed as an obligation. Something that we had to do to fulfill. There was a yoke of the kingdom. There was also a yoke of the law. There was a yoke of the commands of the law. There was a yoke of repentance and a yoke of faith and a yoke of God in general. And Jesus in context right here is saying, look, forget about all the other yokes that the Pharisees and that the religiosity has thrown upon you. Throw those aside and take my yoke. Isn't it amazing how we listen to the world and we're willing to shoulder up under behind the world at all times to be led astray? But when Jesus says, look, I'm here to make life easier for you, make it better for you, help you with your struggles, here, take what I have to offer you, and we just kind of turn around and go in the hard direction. Jesus is saying, take my yoke upon you. Take it and learn. Not a pretend or anything like that, but to take it. It's a beautiful picture of you being teamed up with Jesus. You ever thought about you and Jesus on the team together? Who's going to win? You are. Why? Because he's a winner. Who's going to be successful? You are, because he never loses. Who's going to be right? You are, because he leads you in the paths of righteousness. Who's going to be strong? You are, because in your weakness you are made strong through him. It's a picture of that. It's a picture of the Lord stooping down like he did to pick up and bear the cross. But now he's stooping down to get on your level, wherever you may be, to shoulder up in this yoke with you together and to go through life together. It's a picture of the 23rd Psalm where it says, the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. What does he do? He leads me beside still waters. He puts me in the right pastures. He guides me along the way. He does everything that's for my best interest and good. And Jesus says, man, won't you take my yoke upon you? It's not a picture of a situation of everything being resolved and everything being taken care of and all of our burdens being cast away. Rather, it's a picture of Jesus leading and guiding and helping us to restore us to be what he has called us to be. Jesus reveals his character right here. In this passage of scripture, he says, look, he says, take my yoke upon me and learn from me, for I am gentle and lowly of heart. You'll find rest. His character to be gentle and lowly of heart, Jesus was showing right here that he was a servant, that he was a servant leader, and that you weren't going to do everything alone in life. And it's such a beautiful analogy of the poem, The Footprints, where the guy falls asleep, he has a dream, and he comes before God, and he looks down, and he sees footprints in the sand, and God is revealing to him that this is your life. And in the most difficult times, he sees one set of footprints along the way, and he asks the Lord, in his most difficult times, why did you leave me? Why is there only one set of footprints? He says, no, my child, I was carrying. See, when we yoke up with Jesus in those difficult times, he carries the weight all by himself in love for us, to lead us, to guide us, to strengthen us. Jesus is not here to make your life more miserable. And if we were to do as 1 Peter 5:7 says, to cast our cares on him, for he cares for us, we would know how much he really cares. You see, the invitation is to come, to take his yoke. And if we come and we take his yoke, then you will, did you catch that in scripture? Take my yoke upon me and learn from me, for I am gentle and lowly of heart, and you will find rest for your soul. Jesus wasn't saying you might find rest, that you know what, this might be a better path. There was no question, no doubt. It was an emphatic yes, you will find rest for your soul. Jesus said, if you do life my way, you'll live in peace. Peace with God, peace of God. Jesus was offering an unmatched peace for the souls. He was probably referring to an Old Testament prophecy in Jeremiah chapter 6, verse 16, where the Bible says, thus said the Lord, stand in the ways and see, and ask for the old path where the good way is, and walk in it, and then you will find rest for your souls. But they said, we will not walk in it. How many times has Jesus come to you and said, come, I want to take you in a different direction that's better for your life? You're like, no, I'm good the way I am. I'm good going in the direction that I want to go. And we wonder why we have heartache and hardship and difficulties and stress and pain and weakness. And we're worn out all the time. And we have no rest because we do it our way instead of his way. Jesus invites you to come to take his yoke and do life and find peace and rest for your soul. But here's the thing about Jesus, if you realize this, he never forces it on you. It's just an open invitation. You have to decide, will you come or will you not? And so Jesus says, here's my yoke, here's who I am, here's the character of what happens. And he finally finishes everything up saying, my yoke is easy and my burden is light. The word easy there in the Greek means well-fitted. It means tailor-made. You see, the yoke that Christ has for you is perfect for your life and all the warts and the habits and the hang-ups and the mistakes that you've gone through and what you're going through right now. It's a perfect fit for you. You might ever go and get a prom dress or maybe get fitted for tux guys, and you know, they come out there and they measure you from here to here, and they measure you different ways. I mean, it's like, okay, what are you doing? You know, they kind of invade your privacy. And then whenever all of a sudden you get that and you look at that, I didn't fit, and you put it in, it's like, wow, perfect. That's what Christ has for you. A perfect yoke that's tailor-made. He says, well, my yoke is easy. It's tailor-made for you. It's specifically designed for you. It's designed with all your flaws in account. Don't think that this call from Jesus comes for you to be lazy. No. Not for you to be catered to, but it's a call that if you'll come, you'll find out that this path that Christ wants you to go down is a whole lot better than the path that you want to go down on your own. And Jesus says that my burden is light. He didn't say my burden didn't exist, but he said my burden is light. You see, if the yoke were hard, the burden would be heavy. Well, what do you mean, preacher? Well, remember when David, as a little shepherd boy, came out there and he was told, his dad told him, why don't you take his things to your brothers who are out on the battlefield. He goes out there and he's listening to them, and all of a sudden Goliath comes out there and runs his mouth, and they sit there in the shade. And he looks around and he's like, who's going to go kill this man? Well, nobody is. And Saul said that if whoever kills a man, he's going to give one of his daughters, you know, to be his wife and all this thing. And David's like, well, I'll go fight him. Who is he, man? I've killed a lion. I've killed a bear. I'm not worried about that big old ugly Philistine over there. And Saul came to him, the king, and said, look, if you're going to go fight this man, you need to take my armor. And David picked it up and he couldn't even move in it because he'd never tried it out. It was too big. It was burdensome. It was cumbersome. So how did he go? He went the way he always went, just like he was as a shepherd out there with a sling and five stones. And he went in the power of the Lord with the tailor-made yoke that was placed upon him. And when we realize that God has that perfect yoke for us, that the burden is light, it's easy to work in. The work as a believer is not burdensome. It's not difficult. It's not taxing. The work of a believer is a privilege to be able to show the world how amazing God's grace really is, and show how great His love is, and reveal His faithfulness and His forgiveness to all who confess and repent. When we take the yoke of Christ and He places the likeness of His burden, and most of it's on His shoulders anyway. Have you ever thought about it? When Jesus did tell us to go, did He say, go and you save them? No. He said, go and catch them. I'll claim them. I'll save them. Just go and proclaim the gospel, the easy part. I'll take care of all the difficult stuff. I think so many times we think that we've got to go and we've got to be a part of the result. No, just our going is the faithfulness alone. That's sowing the seed. That's being the sunshine. That's being the rain. That's being what we're supposed to be as a faithful farmer. Living for Jesus is to be a joy because of our salvation. If you've been coming on Wednesday night, you know, understand that joy, how we rejoice through the trial, how we rejoice through the burning of the fire as the gold is being refined, but our faith is more precious than that. We rejoice because our faith brings about salvation. Jesus said, come to me, all you who labor and are heavy laden, I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and lowly of heart. You'll find rest for your soul. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light. So I ask again this morning, are you willing to come to Jesus today? Or do you want to do it your way? The invitation's been sent out. Christ has came and He said, look, come. Come and exchange the burden of your life, your bad decisions, your what you're going through, and take my yoke, tailor-made for you. And I'm going to be shouldered up on the other side so that you can have rest. that you can have peace, so that you can get through this life. Everyone here labors, and some are heavy laden. Have you found rest? Real rest? Maybe you've got a new burden that's been placed on you just this week, and you're trying to bear it. Is Jesus your sounding board, or is he your burden bearer? Are you willing to be instructed by the master teacher? Are you ready to do life his way? Do you not want to be set free from those burdens today and allow him to bear them with you? Many of us constantly pray over the same thing over and over and over and wonder, God, why are you not listening? God, why are you not hearing? God, why are you not answering? And he's asking you to come and exchange that burden. Take his yoke. It's kind of like going to the altar with something. You come, you pray about it, you pray about it, you pray about it, you pray about it. God, I'll give it to you. And then you get up and you take it back to your seat with you. We say we have faith. Do we? Because real faith is revealed in real action. Accepting the invitation. I come. Don't just use Jesus to be your sounding board. The one that you go to with constant concerns, but allow him to help bear burdens today. He's inviting you to come, and I'm inviting you to come to lay your burdens down, to take the yoke that he has for you, this tailor-made for you, so that you can find rest. Are you not tired? Do you believe the word? Do you believe God's faithful? Thank you, man, as well. Let's pray. Father, thank you for your word. Thank you that you make a way for us to go through this life as difficult as it is. You give us a way out. You have a tailor-made yoke for us to bear that fits us on one side and fits you perfectly on the other side, that helps us to get through this life together. God, so many times we cast that aside and we take the yoke of this world, which is always shouldered up with Satan himself and leads us into heartache and hardship and worry and stress and restlessness. Lord, you've offered peace. You've offered rest. God, I know we're weary. Will you help us to exercise faith and come and just trust you every area in our lives? Set us free today, Lord. Thank you for loving us. Thank you for extending an invitation to us all. Help us to be obedient. It's in the name of Jesus I pray. Amen. We're going to stand and they're going to play an invitation song. I don't have the words up here. If God has spoken to your heart, will you come? Will you come?